Good morning. So Belina and I, along with the IC4ML board, are proud to present the 2022 recipient of our organization's beloved Jessie McCanse Award, which Mary Lee had dubbed as the Nobel Prize of Media Literacy. So we're going with that. We haven't been, you know, no copyright issues or anything yet. I don't know. Jessie McCanse was the co-founder of the American Council for Better Broadcasts, which later became the National Telemedia Council, and today is IC4ML. In the 1930s, Jessie was chairman of the Madison chapter of the American Association of University Women. She gave another member, Leslie Spence, a little assignment to form a radio awareness committee that was to last 50 years for both. Spence and McCanse, both English teachers, developed the foundation of our organization's philosophy. In the 1940s, Jessie was the voice on the air of Madison's WHA First in the Nation public radio station, and she did a weekly broadcast on broadcasts for 25 years. As a teacher, she brought the sound, reasonable educational principles and practices that underlie our definition of media literacy. So the award established in 1987 honors her steadfast dedication, leadership role, her 60 years leading our organization, and a champion of the highest standards of excellence, fairness, ethics, and innovation. So the Jessie McCanse Award has been given for those many years to individuals contributing to the field of media literacy over a long sustained period of at least 10 years. It honors them for exemplifying her high principles, her leadership, and her dedication to innovation. We have several of the previous recipients of the award with us today. We have Neil Anderson, Tessa Joles, Carolyn Wilson, Marilyn Cohn is with us on Zoom, and then Henry Jenkins, also our speaker from last night. So today's honoree is, oh, I missed, that was a history, oh, see, I didn't, there you go, pictures of the history, sorry. Here's our honoree, Renee Cherow-O'Leary. Renee has her PhD in communications and culture in media ecology from New York University, her master's of arts in teaching in English from the University of Chicago, and her BA degree in English and philosophy from Barnard College. Renee is president of Education for the 21st Century, a consultancy located in New York and Los Angeles that was founded in 1995. She's an experienced course designer, workshop leader, strategic thinker, catalyst, and creator who has worked with high-level thought leaders at universities, with some of the best minds in the media business, Sesame Workshop and Disney, and with international settings, including the United Nations and the U.S. Institute for Peace. She's currently a faculty member in Rutgers, New York, Arts, Culture, and Media Program, teaching the Senior Colloquium on Imagery, Identity, and Culture, and the Human-Machine Connection, which is the basis of a book she's writing. She's also currently an advisor and advocate for UCLA's Center for Scholars and Storytellers, which hopes to be a bridge between researchers, content creators, and young people. Renee is a professor, author, researcher, futurist, curriculum developer, speaker, conceptualizer of innovative interdisciplinary programs, and internationally recognized educational consultant. She has been a kind friend, a mentor, and a thinking partner for Belina and me, especially this past year as we lost our dear Mary Lee and began to transition the organization from MTC to IC4ML. So it's not enough for us to just tell you about her. So we have a few of her colleagues who would like to give tribute. So I'll welcome up Jessica Brown to share her thoughts.
Hello, friends. Renee, you are the consummate, balanced thinker, doer, and visionary, seriously concerned about education's role as the 21st century marches forward. You take on difficult, seemingly unresolvable challenges via thoughtful, inclusive, and innovative processes. Your big picture always in focus. You wholeheartedly help us all manifest our dreams. The consummate repair of the world, tikkun olam, and coalition builder, champion, I'm having a problem. Championing media literacy globally, your work as a media literacy education proponent and educator continues to enrich the worlds of many audiences, but especially those of the children. The consummate teacher and student, taking rigor to new levels, always curious, always asking questions, carefully listening. You collaborate with the young and not so young among a variety of disciplines, working to develop consequential research so we can all confidently continue our good work in our communities. The model of positivity and the consummate friend and colleague. With admiration, great respect, and much love. Thank you, Renee.
Not done yet. Then we have Marilyn Cohn, who would love to add her thoughts as well. So go ahead, Marilyn. Oh, hold on 1 second. She's muted. Let's see. Now we need to make sure that, go ahead, speak for a moment, Marilyn. Can okay. we hear? Oh, can we can you hear you. Got it.
Okay. Thank you, Karen. I was delighted to learn that this year's recipient of the Jessie McCanse Award is my good friend and colleague, Renee. Renee is so deserving of this special honor. Renee and I first met in the mid-90s when she'd been selected to lead the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences Creating Critical Viewers Project, which we think about with a smile. I see Renee smiling now. The project, based on the curriculum written by Yale educators Jerome and Dorothy Singer, was intended to have a nationwide outreach relying on local NADIS chapters throughout the country. And our Seattle NADIS chapter was one of the groups that I decided to become involved in this project. Our group greatly admired the way in which Renee navigated her leadership role for CCV, which proved to be indeed a most challenging one, always providing support and guidance to us whenever her help was needed. And in fact, our group in Seattle was so impressed with Renee and her vast experience and expertise, both within and outside the world of CCV, that we asked her to serve as a keynote speaker at one of our first media literacy conferences in the late 90s in Washington State. Given Renee's commitment to media literacy and her excellent skills in facilitating collaborations among many diverse groups, which we certainly saw in the Creating Critical Viewers Project, she seemed a natural choice when I had the opportunity to select a co-chair when I was organizing a media literacy research summit for what was known at that time as the Alliance for Media Literate America, which today is known, of course, as the National Association for Media Literacy Education, namely. With Renee's support, we managed to achieve our lofty goals for this summit. We had some very lofty goals, which was held in all those years ago, 2007 in St. Louis. Renee is one of the few colleagues with whom I've ever worked over the years who's managed to achieve success across so many different sectors, both in academia and in business. Whether she's working with thought leaders, at universities or with corporate or non-profit executives, she's managed to gain respect for her many talents and her many skills. I've always been amazed by the range of different projects in which she's managed to immerse herself over the years, all while managing to continue her writing. And actually, she's working on a book right now, so watch for her newest publication sometime soon. I can think of no better choice for this award, which, as Karen mentioned earlier, Marilee had described as the Nobel Prize for Media Literacy. And Renee, congratulations, Renee.
Thank you. So, Renee, are you on mute?
No, I just unmuted.
There you go. The floor is yours, dear.
I am beside myself. I had a picture that I sent to Karen.
Oh, I can share it. Would you share it?
Would you? Because yeah. In it is our Jessica and Marilyn from our very earliest days, not of me, the picture of us, all of us.
Yeah, I'm coming.
Okay.
Yep, I've got it in the show. I just need to.
It's just that one because it's so reflective of what Marilyn was just speaking about. And
did the presenter view.
I might be able to. Here, I can.
Oh, I have it. I have it, Renee. I've
got it too.
The old fashioned way.
Not that one.
Yeah. It's there.
Can people see?
Yes, they can see it.
Okay. In this picture, you can see there are about, 30 people, including Marilyn and Jessica. And this is from 1995. So let me say a few words of deep, deep gratitude. I'm honored to be in the tradition of Jessie McCanse, especially coming from an English teacher background as I do. I think the English teachers have been very much, thank you, Karen, very, very much the people who are the carriers of media literacy. So first of all, let me just say good morning and thank you for this extraordinary honor. Believe me, it was a total surprise. I only found out a couple of days ago when I was unable to come to Madison. Karen said, well, I guess I have to tell you the secret that we're going to unfold when you were here. I am delighted to be among so many friends in the profession, the pioneers who have built and continue to build a vibrant, expanded field of media literacy, and those among you who are newer to this work, but who are breaking ground for the authentic 21st century publications and explorations, answering questions we could have hardly conceived when we began our work 30 years ago. In addition, I could not be more richly rewarded than to be in the first conference whose rationale has been to celebrate Merrily Roe, a founder of a different generation who knew that media were going to transform education and culture. Merrily and I were birthday sisters. It's what we call ourselves. We were both born on August 13th, but in different years. And we always celebrated our birthdays together, especially in recent years, if not in person, then through cards and calls. To me, that was a sign as well of a kind of continuity and commitment to her work. I really did feel in many ways that she was a sister. I just want to tell you, and Marilyn did this quickly, and I will do this quickly, how I got into media literacy. In October of 1995, I received a call from a man named Joe Zespa. He was a member of the board of the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences, the group that gives out the Emmys, and he was a key executive at Colorado Public Television. I had applied for a part-time job with Natus from a small ad that I had seen in the Harvard Education Review months before. I promptly forgot I had applied for the job. It was a total long shot. However, based on my cover letter, I think, months before, Joe offered me the job of the national coordinator of a new program in a new field. Or a new growing field, certainly, media literacy. The project was called Creating Critical Viewers, and it was based on a curriculum developed by Drs. Jerome and Dorothy Singer, scholars at Yale. Joe was a visionary. He wanted the television industry to understand the importance of media literacy. And I found out that this was only reluctantly agreed to by the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences. As Marilyn said, there were some complications. Astonished as I was, I took the job, which meant, among other things, speaking with broadcasters and educators in 17 cities where NADIS had offices about media literacy and about, quote, critical thinking. As an educator, that term was familiar to me, but most broadcasters thought the term meant we were teaching audiences to criticize the media. Not a very welcome thought. So I would arrive in a city, people were very gracious, then they take me to dinner. And then they would ask me some very difficult questions, which would begin, why are we teaching this anyway? Nevertheless, Joe was a powerful and kind voice in the course of my travels, and I met wonderful people like Marilyn, like Jessica, who got it as we were learning together. And these people have been, and Tessa as well, who have been companions from that period to this day. And later I met Karen and Belina, who solidified my commitment to the field. And I could name many, many more from whom I've learned and who have become lifelong friends. In addition, who could have imagined the development of the media, the internet, social media, and so much more? In the mid-90s, the approaching revolution was only very, very dimly on our radar. We were still worried about teaching how advertising can manipulate you and how camera angles and background music complicate meaning. Mark Zuckerberg, I looked this up yesterday, born in 1984, did not even enter Harvard until 2002. And who in 1995 could have predicted the media upheaval of astounding proportions just around the corner? And yet, we did intuit that something was happening. We weren't sure what to call it, but our passion came from the fact that we wanted to understand the phenomena that we could sense, but not yet define. Those of us like me who had read, actually devoured the work of Marshall McLuhan, and who had studied with prescient scholars like Neil Postman of NYU, my doctoral mentor, we were fortunate to have some guidance from those who were forming this field in other scholarly ways. I felt, and I think we all felt, the calm before the storm. We followed our instincts, and here we are. Yet again, we are seeking understanding about the media revolutions that are transforming us in profound ways. We, the community of media literacy explorers, are willing to tread into new territory and to ask critical, that word again, critical questions. I applaud you all and your work, and I'm so grateful for your recognition of mine. And I watched the ceremony last night, and I am so inspired by the winners of the Merrily Row Awards, the International Coalition of Innovative Thinkers, who are now joining to assess and open the challenges of the future. And I know that IC4ML is going to be a gathering place for many more explorers. So thank you very much, and may our work be fruitful and prosper. Thank you.
Virtual hugs to you.
Thank you. I'm delighted and thrilled, really.